Be seated, everyone. Good morning, everyone. This is the case of the people of the state of Colorado versus James Egan Holmes, case number 12 CR 1522. The records reflect that Mr. Holmes is present with his attorneys, Mr. King, Ms. Brady, Ms. Higgs, Ms. Nelson, and Ms. Spengler. And the people are represented by Mr. Orman, Ms. Pearson, Ms. Teach McGuire, and Mr. Edwards. The reason I took a little longer than anticipated is that as I was getting ready to come out, the jury sent out another question. So there are two questions now that I need to talk to you about. First, the record should reflect that pursuant to my ruling yesterday, we sent back a TV and DVD player this morning, and we timed it. So we took it back an hour after we gave it to the jury. And for the record, the reason I did an hour is because all of the DVDs and CDs that the jury wanted to view amounted to about 50 minutes or totaled about 50 minutes in duration, 5-0. And it seemed to me that it was important to give them time to take a disc out, put another disc in, set things up. So with all of that, I thought 60 minutes would allow them to play each exhibit once. So I wanted to have the record clear on that. The other thing I wanted to clarify is that yesterday I discussed the Court of Appeals decision in Jefferson. I'm aware that the Supreme Court has granted cert in that case, and it's on the specific issue related to the jury's access to certain evidence in an unsupervised manner. But I'm not relying on the specific holding in Jefferson. I'm relying on Jefferson for the law, and then that's all I quoted it for yesterday. I was aware of the cert being granted yesterday. I just wanted to make a record of that. I still feel it's appropriate for me to rely on it. Jefferson, I think, does a good job of discussing the state of the law in Colorado right now based on DiBella and Frasco. DiBella is capital D, small e, capital B, E, L, L, A, and Frasco is F-R-A-S-C-O. All right, now to the questions from this morning. First, the jury submitted a question that I have marked as jury question number 4 during deliberations in phase 1 of the sentencing hearing. And it's more of a request than a question. It reads as follows. The exhibit P-TR-400 is a DVD which will not play. As of now, we have been unable to review it. So that was one. As I was getting ready to come out to talk to the attorneys about that, they submitted another question, which I have marked as jury question number 5. During deliberations in phase 1 of the sentencing hearing, it reads as follows. We are requesting clarification on the wording of alleged aggravating factor number 2. Depending on how it is read, it could be interpreted two ways. One, did the defendant intend to kill a child under 12 specifically? Two, did the defendant intend to kill and kill the child under 12? Let's start with the last one and work our way back if we can. And let me tell you what my proposed response would be as to the last one, and then I'll have my staff distribute a copy of the questions and my proposed response, at least to this one. What I would propose is to say something along the lines of the following. Dear members of the jury, this is in response to your request for clarification on the wording of alleged aggravating factor number 2. With respect to this alleged aggravating factor, the prosecution has to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant intentionally killed a child who had not yet attained 12 years of age. The prosecution cannot meet its burden of proof with respect to this alleged aggravating factor by proving beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant intended to kill and that one of the victims killed happened to be less than 12 years of age. Would you please distribute copies of that proposed response and then copies of the two questions? Oh, I do have them here. Thank you. One for each side. And then I'll let council take a little time to review my proposed response and the question, and then tell me how they want to proceed. And you can take as much time as you wish. And just so that you folks know, that second sentence in my proposed answer is verbatim what the elemental instruction says, which I think is important for me to do. Mr. Orman, do the people need more time?
No.
All right, what's the people's position?
I believe that the response that you have prepared is accurate, and I have no objection to it.
All right, does the defense need more time?
No, Your Honor, we're fine with the court's proposed answer.
Okay, great. That's how we will proceed. Let's talk about the other question then. I don't know if it's our equipment, but whatever, sometimes apparently we have this issue with disks from the district attorney's office because of the way that the district attorney's office burns disks. It's not compatible apparently with our equipment or the equipment that we have available to take back to the jury room. That equipment will not play P-DR-400. What I propose is saying something along the following lines. Dear members of the jury, this is in response to your note, which indicates that P-DR-400 will not play and that you have been unable to view it. The court provides you a different copy of that exhibit that can be played on the court's TV-DVD player. The TV, not dash, but slash DVD player, will be provided to you for 10 minutes as the recording is 8 minutes long. The court reminds you that you are not to give any exhibit undue weight or emphasis. Consistent with this instruction, you may only play P-TR-400 one time. Finally, you may not play any other exhibits without authorization from the court. And one time, again, is in bold font. Would you please distribute copies of that proposed answer to the attorneys? It's one for each of them. I'll give you folks have a moment to review that, and then we will proceed.
Your Honor, can I ask a question?
Yes.
Do I take it from the response that you've actually figured out a way to convert it and put it onto another disk?
No, we don't have it. No, that would be up to you if you can provide something. I don't. My staff tried it, and we couldn't play it on our equipment, so.
I think that it may need to be played on a computer. I'm not positive of that, but I believe that is the case.
What we had, a laptop, and it wouldn't play on the laptop.
We need that. We need a problem.
I think there has to be specific software.
Right. We don't have that. That's the problem.
And I think that we can provide a laptop that does not have access to the internet that will be able to play it on the laptop.
All right. Does the laptop have any other information on it?
I, Your Honor, I haven't had a chance to talk to our paralegal specifically.
It doesn't work.
So I'm not going to make that representation to the court unless I know for sure.
So. I've been told it doesn't, but I really want to investigate that before I say that to you.
Okay.
Your Honor, so.
All right. Does the defense have a position on whether it would be appropriate to send a different laptop? Obviously, I'd let you inspect it first, just in case, but...
We would prefer the laptop versus substituting a piece of evidence.
Okay, that's fine.
If I just have a few minutes to go inquire, Your Honor.
That's fine.
Your Honor?
Yes.
In speaking to the paralegal, this computer is set up so that there's no data on it that can be accessed. There's the software to run the program, and there is software to do other things, but there's no Word files on it or word processing files. There's no photographs on it. There's no videos on it. It's a computer set up to be able to do this with nothing else on it except for other software that can do other things, read other files and so forth.
Your Honor, an alternative could also be to bring him into the courtroom and let him watch it in the courtroom without anyone else in the courtroom.
Will it play in the courtroom? I mean, based on the courtroom's equipment, do you know?
If it's hooked up over there, my paralegal is saying it will. And I bet she can set it up so that one of your bailiffs could just press play.
Okay.
And we can do that.
All right. That's probably the best way to go. Because then I don't take any risks with them having a laptop that belongs to either party. So
I agree, Your Honor.
Okay. All right. And you're okay with that, right, Ms. Brady?
Yes, sir.
All right. But it would not be in the presence of counsel or the parties or anyone else. So I would clear the courtroom, and my bailiff would simply be in here to press play and then would leave, but would come back 8 minutes later or 10 minutes later or so, and then we would... I would instruct them along those lines that we would 10 minutes later my bailiff would come and take him back to the jury room. All right. So let me draft an answer. If you don't mind waiting for me, just so that we're all on the same page in terms of the answer that I send back to them. If you can remain here for just a moment, I can go back and draft an answer consistent with my ruling, Mr. Orman.
That's fine. And while we're doing that, I'll have my paralegal set it up. And then can we get the exhibit so that we can get it ready to play, and then she can get it all set up and show your staff how to get it running.
Do you mind, Ms. Brady, if we give the exhibit back to Mr. Orman so they can try it, test it, see if it really will work here in the courtroom? Is that okay?
It's fine.
Okay. Can you do that, please? Can you retrieve that? Okay, we'll be. I'll be on recess then for just a moment. If everyone would stay here, please. James Egan Holmes, case number 12-CR-1522. The record should reflect that Mr. Holmes is present with his attorneys, and the same prosecutors are present. We continue to be outside the presence of the jury. Here is the proposed response. It reads as follows: This is in response to your note, which indicates that P-TR-400 will not play and that you have been unable to view it. The court does not have the software necessary to play this exhibit. Therefore, the court will allow you to view it in the courtroom. Before you enter the courtroom, the court will clear the courtroom and will turn off the closed-circuit camera. You will be in the courtroom alone, and no one will be allowed in the courtroom while you view P-TR-400. One of my bailiffs will initially be in the courtroom to play the exhibit for you, but will exit the courtroom when the exhibit starts playing. The court reminds you that you are not to give any exhibit undue weight or emphasis. Consistent with this instruction, you will only be allowed to be in the courtroom with this exhibit for 10 minutes, since the exhibit is approximately 8 minutes long. Further, You may only play this exhibit one time. Are the people okay with this proposed response?
We're okay with it, Your Honor.
All right, the defense, Ms. Brady?
Yes.
Okay, that's how we will proceed then. And I'll ask the sheriff, once the courtroom is clear, to not allow anybody in the courtroom. We will turn off the closed circuit camera. And then when all that has happened and the courtroom is clear, one of my bailiffs will bring the jury into the courtroom, we'll hit play, and then we'll exit and we'll time it for 10 minutes before my bailiff comes back and gets the jury back into the jury room, okay? All right, the court will be in recess. Thank you.